Hi, my name is Tukni. I'm an educator at the Intero Science Center, but we are currently filming from my home, so welcome to my basement. Today we'll be doing a DNA extraction experiment. Before we get into that, we're going to talk a bit about DNA and the research techniques behind studying it. So let's jump in.
DNA, or deoxyribonucleic acid, is a genetic material in all living things. Most of the DNA in a eukaryote is found in the nucleus. DNA determines almost everything that you are, from your eye color to how your body responds to different stimuli, and much more. This is because DNA holds instructions for making proteins in your body, which are the structural and functional units of cells. How does DNA have the instructions? To understand that, we'll need to take a closer look at DNA structure. If you zoom in real close to look at DNA, it'll look a little like a twisted ladder. We call that shape a double helix. The two strands of twisted DNA are made of small molecules called nucleotides. Each nucleotide is made up of a phosphate, deoxyribose sugar, and a nitrogenous base. There are four nitrogenous bases in DNA: cytosine, guanine, adenine, and thymine. These bases hydrogen bond with each other in a specific way called complementary base pairing: cytosine with guanine and adenine with thymine. I like to remember it as apple in the tree, car in the garage. The order of these bases are the instructions for creating everything in living things. Understanding DNA structure also helps you better understand DNA replication, a process that creates a copy of your DNA. DNA replication is a bit more complex than what we have time to cover here, and involves things like a replication bubble, single-stranded binding proteins, leading and lagging strands, and much more. We recommend you doing a bit more research or checking out our PDF for more info. DNA in your cells is usually double-stranded. In order to access the DNA and start replication, DNA needs to be made single-stranded. A protein called helicase binds to double-stranded DNA and breaks the hydrogen bonds between the nitrogenous bases, separating the DNA into single strands. From here, primers can be added by the protein primase. Primers are short RNA sequences that act like a starting line for where DNA can be made. DNA polymerase, an enzyme that makes DNA, can then bind to the primer and start reading the original DNA strands to determine what new complementary bases need to be added. If there is a cytosine, it will add a complementary guanine nucleotide. If there's an adenine, a complementary thymine, and so on, building the new molecule of DNA. Scientists were able to use their understanding of DNA replication to replicate, pun intended, that process in a laboratory using a scientific technique called polymerase chain reaction. To prepare for a polymerase chain reaction, scientists extract and purify DNA from living things. That purified DNA gets mixed with a DNA polymerase called TAC, deoxyribonucleotide triphosphates, which are used to build the new DNA strands, and primers that bind to the DNA in the region you want to copy and tell TAC where to start. PCR mimics the process of DNA replication happening in your cells through a repetitive process of denaturing DNA, adding primers, and building new strands of DNA. PCR is able to duplicate your target sequence DNA approximately every 2 minutes. This means if I had one copy of my target sequence, after 2 minutes I'd have two copies, then 4, 8, 16, and so on. This technique allows us to make 1 billion copies of DNA in less than 2 hours.
This is a really useful technique since many genetics-related experiments are dependent on a large amount of DNA to do any analysis. And PCR is able to amplify from a relatively small amount of starting DNA, which is important for sensitive experiments like early diagnosis of viral infections like COVID-19, as you can see in this research paper, or for other things like getting DNA from a crime scene. PCR is the foundation of many biotechnological applications, from DNA fingerprinting, to mapping out evolutionary trees, to cloning, to identifying genetic mutations, and much more. While most of us probably don't have the right equipment at home to do PCR, many of us can do DNA extraction at home from things we already have. So let's extract some DNA. For DNA extraction at home, you will need alcohol. You can use isopropyl or rubbing alcohol. If you don't have that, you can use something that has a high alcohol content. Liquid dish soap, salt, spoons, a skewer or a toothpick, something that has DNA in it. You can use a lot of things for this, like frozen or fresh produce. Today I'll be using frozen strawberries. A clear cup, something you can see through easily and is taller than it is wide. A measuring cup, coffee filters or a kitchen strainer or a cheesecloth, a plastic baggie, and a funnel, and lastly some water. If you're doing this experiment by yourself, make sure you have the supervision or permission from a parent or guardian, especially if you're taking their groceries for your experiment. Mom, can you use our groceries for a science experiment?
Yes, it's okay, Toki.
Okay, thank you. See, it's important. All right, let's get started. For the experiment, the first thing you're going to want to do is to get your alcohol into the freezer so it can chill. We'll be using it later on. Next, you want to grab your produce and you want to put that into your baggie. You want to seal up your bag, trying to get out the air, and then you want to mash those strawberries until they're mush. Next, what you want to do is to get your measuring cup and measure out a quarter cup of water and add 1 teaspoon of salt and 1 teaspoon of soap to that mixture. You can see I've already measured that. Pour that mixture into the bag. Close it up again, taking out the air. You want to mix this together. Looks good. All right, you want to grab your cup. You want to put the funnel into that cup and the coffee filter into that funnel. You're going to pour this into the coffee filter so that it can strain out the liquid. You don't need to use it all. Once it's done straining, you can take out your funnel. Get your alcohol from the freezer and you want to gently pour it over the strained liquid. So you want to tilt the glass to the side and gently stream the alcohol along the side of the glass, so that the alcohol forms a layer on top of the strawberry mixture. You wanna give this a couple of minutes to sit and watch what happens.
So the little strands that you're seeing form in the alcohol layer are DNA.
After a couple of minutes, if you look at the top of the glass, you're gonna notice some strands forming. That's DNA. So if you grab your skewer, you can gently grab those strands and take them out. Congratulations! You have extracted DNA at home. This is so cool. Hey, so the experiment isn't done yet. You may have noticed there's a lot of room in the experiment to change up different things. We would like to challenge you to change a variable in the experiment with the goal of increasing your DNA yield, or increasing the amount of DNA you get at the end of the extraction. We recommend doing a couple of things. Doing some research about what each chemical does, and taking some good notes about changes you make. And if you can, measuring out the DNA you get from the original experiment, and measuring it again when you change the experiment. And it's okay if sometimes your experiment doesn't work. If you can see by the mess I've made, there's a lot of troubleshooting and a lot of failure that happens with doing experiments. And that's all right. That's a part of science. I hope you had fun and learned how to extract DNA from plants. And by the way, that's a hot tip. Some plants, they are polyploid, meaning they have more than 2 copies of their chromosome. So that might be a good place to start. And that's it. Do our challenge, extract DNA, have fun. Bye.